All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness.
Family Educational Television presents Family Bible Study. Leading the study is Harold Camping, president of Family Stations Incorporated. In the first segment, Mr. Camping conducts a thorough study of selected Bible verses. In the second segment, our studio audience will offer questions in response to today's Bible study. With the Bible as our guide, we now begin Family Bible Study.
Welcome to another Family Bible Study. One of the most marvelous and wonderful things about Family Bible Study is that we are studying the Bible. And when we study the Bible, we really get into truth. We begin to get into issues that otherwise we would have no idea at all about or concerning. As a matter of fact, the Bible has a whole lot to say about what the future of this world is, and everybody wishes they had a crystal ball. Everybody wishes that they could look at it and know what the stock market is going to do tomorrow, or whether how healthy they would be next week or whatever. We all want to know the future. Well, the Bible doesn't tell us anything about the stock market tomorrow. It doesn't tell us anything about our personal health tomorrow, or a lot of other questions that we might have, or whether we're going to be successful in finding a job or not. But the Bible does give us a tremendous amount of information that relates to the final destination of this world and all of its inhabitants. And because the end of the world has to do with every human being, it becomes a very, very personalized question. And we should have a very personal interest in it, because we're all going to be impacted by what we find there. Therefore, we are glad that we can have the freedom to look into the Bible and discover what we can, discover anything that we can that might give us further insights. In fact, we're commanded to do that. Remember 2 Peter chapter 3, that we are commanded to look for and hasten unto the day of God, wherein the heavens will be destroyed and the earth will be destroyed, and there will be a new heaven and a new earth. We are to look for that, and in order to look for that, we have to look in the Bible and examine the Bible more carefully than ever. Moreover, we're also learning that we're living in a day, or because we're living in a day that we may be so very close to the end, it is God's purpose to unveil additional information from His Word. Now, it's always been there. God does not change His Word. He does not now take the blinders off of certain verses that before we couldn't even read them at all. We've always been able to read them down through history. But God has not opened the spiritual eyes of those who read them, even though they may be God-fearing men and women, because it was not His timetable so to do. God kept the focus of the church, of the body of believers, on the important task of getting the gospel out into the world. That was the ongoing pressure on the church, on the believers. Get the gospel out. Now, you are to look for the end. You're to remember there is an end. You've got to face the fact that there is a judgment day. You are to remember that this is the most important thing that you should be doing, is keeping in mind that we're only strangers and pilgrims here, and that it's all going to come to an end, but God did not give us any more detail. But in our day, we're finding that God is opening up a whole lot of verses that before theologians had no idea what to do with. And so we have been very carefully looking at quite a number of passages to discover what else has God to teach us. Now, we've spent considerable time with Zechariah 14. And when we came to verse 5, we found this very unusual statement, and we're now going to develop it to see what else we can learn. Ye shall flee to the valley of the mountains, for the valley of the mountains shall reach unto Azel. Yea, ye shall flee like as ye fled from before the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. And the Lord my God shall come, and all the saints with thee. Now, so far as we look at this verse, we find that God is relating Isaiah to an earthquake and to the end of the world. Why do we say the end of the world? Because it says here, "And the Lord my God shall come, and all the saints with thee." And so we wonder, what is this earthquake? And as a matter of fact, when we search the Bible, we don't find anywhere in the historical account that during the days of Isaiah there was an earthquake, even though we find this reference to an earthquake. But we do find other references to Isaiah, and we find other references to an earthquake. And so we have to take what God has given us and see if we can assimilate this, and if we can tie this together and finally begin to understand what is God really teaching us here. If we go back to Revelation 16, first of all, we can know that we're on track when we equate the earthquake with the end of the world. Now, Zechariah 14 already does this in verse 5, because remember, it talks about the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah, and the Lord my God shall come and all the saints with thee. Where we, long ago when we studied that, we saw that without question, that is talking about the time when Christ comes to rapture the believers, and it is right at the end of the world, the last day. But in Revelation 16, God uses other language in describing the end of the world, and he says in verse 15, "Behold, I come as a thief," and that's already a clue phrase that we find again and again. Remember, we saw it in 2 Peter 3, verse 10, "For the Lord will come as a thief in the night." We saw it in 1 Thessalonians 5, where it talks about that he will come as a thief in the night for the unbelievers. And so, in verse 15 of Revelation 16, God again underscores that. "Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and see his shame. And he gathered them together into a place called in the Hebrew tongue Armageddon." And we know Armageddon, the mountain of Megiddo, is really what this means, is a figure of speech pointing to Judgment Day. The final confrontation of all of the wicked of the world, including Satan and all of the fallen angels, together with all of the wicked of the world who have ever stood, and Christ, on the other hand, is called the Battle of Armageddon. Now, it's not actually a battle. It's a figure that God is using because in the historical sense, when two nations are at war, there's been battle after battle after battle, and then finally there is the final decisive battle. The final decisive battle, when one nation becomes a complete victor over the other, and what is left in the field are the rotting dead corpses of those who have been slain, of the vanquished enemy. And that's the figure that God uses of Judgment Day. Of course, the corpses of those who have been slain are the unsaved. They are spiritually dead. They are corpses in that sense. And they are not out rotting in the field. They are cast away into a place called hell. They are banished from God forevermore. Well, that's the Battle of Armageddon. It is the Day of Judgment, and it's a foregone conclusion that God will win. It's a very significant, remember, that just ahead of this came the final tribulation period, and during that period, Satan wins. Remember Revelation 13, where it says in verse 7, "And it was given unto him to make war with the saints and to overcome them, and power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations." In other words, it's a purpose of God that Satan will be winning, because God has brought the church under judgment. And that's the period of time we're living in right now. There's increasing evidence that this is so. This is the character of the church of our day. They do not want truth. They do not want to be reminded of where truth is. But at any rate, in Revelation 16, right after the Battle of Armageddon, coincidental with it, we read in verse 17, "And the seventh angel poured out his vial into the air, and there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne saying, "It is done." And there were voices and thunders and lightnings, and there was a great earthquake. That's what we're interested in. A great earthquake, such as was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great. In other words, God is equating a great earthquake with when it is done. It is the end. And the three great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell. And great Babylon came in remembrance before God to give unto her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. And every island fled away, and the mountains were not found. And there fell upon men a great hail out of heaven, every stone about the weight of a talent. And men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, for the plague thereof was exceeding great. Well, God is simply emphasizing, using language to underscore the awfulness of Judgment Day, the awfulness of hell. But he's using the phrase, a great earthquake. And that's what we're interested in, because in Zechariah 14, it talks about the earthquake in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. Strange language. Then when we go back to Amos chapter 1, in Amos chapter 1 in the Old Testament, remember he's one of these Old Testament prophets that prophesied concerning the end of the world and particularly the final tribulation period. And his prophecy began, we read in verse 1 of Amos 1, the words of Amos, who was among the herdmen of Tekoa, which he saw concerning Israel in the days of Uzziah, king of Judah. You see Uzziah again there? In the days of Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel, 2 years before the earthquake. Before the earthquake. In other words, he's prophesying of a time that's just ahead of the end of the world, the great earth, some kind of an earthquake that has to do with Uzziah. Now, we have one other reference to Uzziah that will tie in eventually, and that is in Isaiah chapter 6. And this also is a very, very significant tie-in to Uzziah. Even though God does, and when we read the historical record of Uzziah, we don't find any reference to an earthquake. Nevertheless, God is identifying him with a great earthquake of some kind. And in Isaiah 6, verse 1, we read, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord lifted, sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple." And then we have the account, and we're not going to go into it at this point because we're going to do it later on. But the account is that Isaiah sees the throne of God above which are the seraphims, which are a picture of God in judgment. In judgment. And he says, "Woe is me, I'm a man of unclean lips." And here that has to do with the death of Uzziah. And, of course, judgment has to do with the earthquake. Even though we don't see the word earthquake in Isaiah 6, nevertheless, it is implied that this is a picture looking at Judgment Day. It's looking at Christ coming as the judge of all the earth. So we see that King Uzziah becomes very important in the biblical language somehow. Now, when we go back to 2 Kings and 2 Chronicles, where it talks about King Uzziah, first of all, remember, in 2 Kings, there's very little said. We'll make reference to what there is in time. But most of the reference is found in 2 Chronicles chapter 26. 2 Chronicles chapter 26. Now, Uzziah, incidentally, is also called, what was his other name? Azariah. Azariah. You may see him spoken of as Uzziah, or did I say that right? Let's see, what is it in 2 Kings? Azariah? Yes, I believe that's correct. Azariah, and And in another place we find Uzziah, but it's always the same man. Now, when we read about Uzziah in 2 Chronicles chapter 26, we read, first of all, that he became king when he was 16 years of age. And remember last time in our last study, we just briefly went over the fact that he actually became a co-regent with his father. His father was not a very wise king. His name was Amaziah. And in the midpoint of Amaziah's reign, he wanted to fight with the king of Israel. And the king of Israel remonstrated with him, "Why do you want to do that?" But he insisted. And so Amaziah fought with Joash, the king of Israel. And the king of Israel conquered him and actually broke down part of the wall of Jerusalem and took a number of hostages, including the king himself. Then the people made young Azariah or Uzziah king on the throne, because temporarily they didn't have a king. Their king had been taken captive. And so when Israel freed Amaziah, Uzziah's father, a little bit later, now we have two kings on the throne. And so we read in 2 Chronicles 26, verse 1, "Then all the people of Judah took Uzziah, who was 16 years old, and made him king in the room of his father Amaziah." Now that statement sounds like this happened right at the death of Amaziah. Incidentally, Amaziah continued to do foolishly, because we read in 2 Chronicles 25, verse 27, this is now dealing with the end of the life of Amaziah. Midpoint in his reign, he did foolishly, his son was put on the throne with him. "Now after the time that Amaziah did turn away from following the Lord, they made a conspiracy against him in Jerusalem, and he fled to Lachish, but they sent to Lachish after him and slew him there. And they brought him upon horses and buried him with his fathers in the city of Judah." And so Amaziah was not a very good king. He obviously had a lot of weaknesses, and the people recognized this, and finally they rebelled against him and killed him. They wanted Uzziah to be king alone. And so when we look at verse 1 of 2 Chronicles 26, we have to look at it in the light of this foregoing in order to get the picture. Uzziah actually had been reigning as co-regent for a number of years, but now he's reigning alone upon the death of his father. Verse 2, "He built Eloth and restored it to Judah. After that, the king slept with his fathers. 16 years old was Uzziah when he began to reign, and he reigned 52 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Jechaliah of Jerusalem. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that his father Amaziah did." Now, in other words, his father Amaziah was basically a God-fearing king, but a very foolish king. At times he had done very foolishly. Incidentally, Uzziah was not a perfect king either, and we're going to see that as we go along. Because if we hold your finger in 2 Chronicles 26 and go back to 2 Kings, where we find a little bit more information about him, we read in chapter 15 of 2 Kings, chapter 15, verse 2, 16 years old, this is talking about Azariah now, who is Uzziah. Azariah, or Uzziah, was 16 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 52 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Jechaliah of Jerusalem, and he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, according to all that his father Amaziah had done, save that the high places were not removed. The people sacrificed and burned incense still on the high places. Now, that's the only account of his life found in 2 Kings until just before his death. And we'll have to look at that presently. But during his lifetime, he served God, but he did not remove all the high places. In other words, he still allowed the worship of false gods in the land. to some degree. And that's like a church, you know, that does quite well. They get a lot of their doctrine straight and their practices straight, and yet there are things that they don't straighten out. They don't correct properly. Maybe they aren't following the rules carefully as to who should be elders and deacons, whatever it may be. And eventually that is the feed point where Satan comes in and is able finally to bring judgment or bring that church into trouble. Well, let's go back to 2 Chronicles 26 now. In verse 5 of 2 Chronicles 26, he sought God in the days of Zechariah, who had understanding in the visions of God, and as long as he sought the Lord, God made him to prosper. Now there's a fundamental principle that God sets forth. This man reigned for 52 years, not always for many years in his early life. He was co-regent with his father, who was basically a God-fearing king, but very foolish, did some very foolish things so that eventually the people killed him. But this son was prospered by the Lord. Now remember last time we looked at the 52 years. He reigned 52 years. And remember what that immediately reminded us of? The acceptable year of the Lord. 52 has to do with 52 weeks. That's what God has ordained within the calendar. That's not something that man has decided upon. God has designed the universe to have 365 days in a year, and he's broken it up into 7-day periods called weeks. And therefore, if we multiply 7 times 52, we get 364 days, which is almost a whole year. And it shows that 52 is identified always with a whole year. We can't avoid that. And so the reign of Uzziah, we're going to see, is a picture of the reign or the New Testament church as it sends the gospel out into the whole world throughout the New Testament era. And here God is using the language of a king ruling in the land to describe the conquests of the church as it sends the gospel into the world. Look at verse 6. And he went forth and warred against the Philistines. Okay, now, in the Bible, who are the Philistines a picture or type of? The enemy of Satan, right? The enemy Satan. And where is the war joined? Wherever the gospel goes out, we are confronting Satan and trying to vanquish him, and the gospel, if it's purely brought, will vanquish Satan. It will win, will it not? And so he warred against the Philistines. That's a picture of the gospel going out into the hinterlands of the world, which are controlled by Satan, but now come under the hearing of the gospel. And he break down the wall of Gath, and the wall of Jabneh, and the wall of Ashdod, indicating three walls here, which would emphasize what? Purpose of God. It was a purpose of God that the gospel will be successful, just as Uzziah was very successful as he warred. And he built cities about Ashdod and amongst the Philistines. He built cities. Now Ashdod was in the land of the Philistines. And now Uzziah built cities there. What does that tell you spiritually? What's the picture of that spiritually? As we send the gospel into the world, and here's a community that to date there are no believers within it, and they're under a false god of some kind or another, some pagan religion, and then the missionaries come, and a beachhead is established, one person becomes a believer, and the next thing more become believers, and the next thing there's a city of God right there within what had been the wilderness of the enemy. It is this city of believers who are now trusting the Lord, and that's the way God has done this throughout the New Testament era as the gospel has gone out. And yet that gospel, that city of believers, that spiritual Jerusalem that exists there is still amongst the enemy. The enemy is still out there all the time. The Philistines are still there, are they not? We are always surrounded by the world. And God helped him against the Philistines. And of course, that's a given, isn't it? As we are faithfully sending forth the gospel, God helps us because God applies that word to the lives of those who hear, and they do become believers. God helped him against the Philistines and against the Arabians that dwelt in Gerbala and Mehunims and the Mehunims. Now, I have no idea. The Bible doesn't give us any more information about these two names here. But again, God is simply saying, God is, he's going to focus on the Philistines. He's talking here about the Arabians. And in verse 8, he's going to talk about the Ammonites. So you got the number 3 featured again. You have the Philistines who are being conquered. You have the Arabians who are being conquered. And you have the Ammonites who have been conquered because they gave gifts to Uzziah. Now, incidentally, to give gifts to Uzziah, what would that be a picture of spiritually? As we send out the gospel, then there are those who do become believers, and they are gifts to Christ. In other words, they are the first fruits that come in because the gospel has successfully gone out. And so here again, it is the purpose of God to assault the enemy, typified by the Philistines, the Arabians, the Ammonites, and God will win. They are conquered. They bring gifts back to God. As people become saved, they enter into the kingdom of God and become the property of God Himself. And His name spread abroad even to the entering in of Egypt. I wonder why Egypt is mentioned here. And Egypt, of course, is always a picture in the Bible of being in bondage to sin. And the cause of Christ, as it has gone out throughout the New Testament era, has gone into the very entering in of Egypt. In other words, it's gone wherever people have been in bondage to sin, and they have come into salvation. And then it says, "For he strengthened himself exceedingly." And has the church throughout the New Testament era, remember, we're looking at Uzziah now as a picture of the New Testament church during the whole acceptable year of the Lord, which is the whole New Testament era. Has the church been successful as it has heralded forth the gospel? And the answer is yes. Yes. There's no human being that God intended to save throughout the New Testament era who did not become saved. And that is, everyone who God intended to save did become saved, and Satan, with all of his wiles and all of his stratagems, has been unable to stop this because it is God's plan to save. And the church has become strong throughout the world. You know, we have seen that the pervasive nature of the Christian gospel as it has gone into land after land after land. Well, then we go on in verse 9, "Moreover, Uzziah built towers in Jerusalem at the corner gate and at the valley gate and at the turning of the wall and fortified them." He built towers. Now that again is the defenses that he established to protect Jerusalem. And who is our high tower? The Lord Jesus himself. He is our defense. Even as Uzziah had these towers, so Christ is our tower of defense. "He built towers in the desert and digged many wells, for he had much cattle." Why is the Bible talking about that? Why is he talking about that? Because you see, the world out there spiritually throughout the New Testament era is a desert. It is a desert. And yet there's going to be water flowing there, the water of the gospel. And it's typified here by the digging of many wells, for he had much cattle, both in the low country and in the plains, husbandmen also. and vine dressers in the mountains and in Carmel, for he loved husbandry. In other words, he was very fascinated by cattle, and he had a lot of cattle out there, and God is using that as a picture of the believers as we come in. Are we cattle, spiritually speaking? Yeah, we're all sheep, are we not? We definitely are sheep, lambs, because we have drunk copiously of the water of the gospel, we are in strength, and so we see this happening here also in the physical sense that it's the development of the gospel throughout the New Testament era. Notice it says he had vine dressers in the mountains, and he had much cattle, husbandmen also. In other words, God has his missionaries that have been going out. All of this is just a picture. It's a portrait of the sending forth of the gospel throughout the New Testament era. Now God changes the figure a little bit. Verse 11, moreover, Uzziah had a host of fighting men that went out to war by bands, according to the number of their account by the hand of Giel, the scribe, and Maaseiah, the ruler, under the hand of Hananiah, one of the chief's captains. Does the Bible portray the sending forth of the gospel as a war? Remember, we have that song, Onward Christian Soldiers, marching as to war with the cross of Jesus going on before. Is that just a figment of someone's imagination? Is that just a cute poem? Is that just to kind of get us our blood stirring a little bit? Or is that right? Does that identify with the Bible? Yeah, the Bible talks about the fact that we are soldiers, and that we are to keep our eyes, not get preoccupied with other things. We are, because we are at war. In fact, remember in Ephesians 6, put on the whole armor of God, because you wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers in high places. And then it talks about the shield of faith and our feet shod with the all of the panoply that is the armor that is put on, all has to do with being prepared to send out the gospel. We are at war with the enemy, and we are out to defeat the enemy. And so Uzziah also had a host of fighting men. Now the next verse has a surprise for us, a great surprise. The whole number of the chief of the fathers of the mighty men of valor were 2,600. Oh, that isn't a surprising verse. It's the next one. This verse, there were the chiefs, the leaders of his army were 2,600 men. And we, of course, can identify with that 2,600 real quickly. Remember, we have learned that every time we see a number in the Bible, we immediately wonder what spiritual lesson is developed in that number. Why did God give us that number? And God always has a purpose for a number. It's not there accidentally. He could have easily said the whole number of the chief of the fathers of the mighty men of valor were great or whatever, but he gave a number, 2,600. And of course, 2,600 is the multiple of 2 times 13 times 100. 2,600. And 100 is a completeness, 2 is the number of the church, 13 is the number that signifies the second return of Christ. And so God is simply saying here that his army typified the sending forth of the gospel right up until Christ comes again. And it would be a complete army. It would be sufficient to build the church. I think we can see all of that in the number 2,600 who led. But the next verse is the surprising one. And under their hand was an army, 300,000 and 7,500, that made war with mighty power to help the king against the enemy. Here God is telling us the size of the army over which his captains warred with. They were 307,500 people, 307,500 men. Now, this is a surprising verse, because when we look at that number, 307,500, we wonder, why did God give us that number? Why did God give us that number? And frankly, I don't know why. Because when I try to break it down into its important numbers, it breaks down into 103 times something, and 103 cannot be broken down further. And I'm not aware how God uses the number 103 in the Bible to illustrate any spiritual meaning. Now, there may be, it's simply that I have not understood that as yet, or there may be another reason why he gave us 307,500. I do know this, however, that this number is given to us. It's a very important number. It does have spiritual meaning of some kind, but I want to testify to you, I don't know what it is. I don't know what it is. I do know it has to be something in the setting of the whole New Testament era, because Isaiah is a picture of the church as it brings the gospel throughout the New Testament era. And those are things we can know, but there comes a time, and the lesson that I want to draw out of this is that as we study the Bible and we come to a verse or a phrase or a number that we don't understand, don't fudge. Don't start speculating. Don't think, well, I haven't done my job unless I understand this now and can talk about it. There comes a time when we have to say very humbly, I don't know. And that's also part of the lesson that God gives us. Whereas we can so very, very frequently, we look at a number and we can begin to see why God has used that number. Here God has given us a number that does not give itself up at all readily. Now, that doesn't mean there isn't a meaning. It just means that at this point in time, we don't know what it is. Well, then we go on in verse 14. And Uzziah prepared for them throughout all the host shields and spears and helmets and habergeons and bows and slings to cast stones. In other words, he's a very, very careful general, captain, who is ruling his armies. He is getting the latest kind of weapons. He made in Jerusalem engines invented by cunning men to be on the towers and upon the bulwarks, to shoot arrows and great stones withal. And his name spread far abroad, for he was marvelously helped till he was strong. Now you see, we find here that he would be like a modern dictator who has bought all the latest devices, the finest planes and tanks and guns of various kinds, and in order that he could assault the enemy. And in other words, he took his task seriously of defending Israel, of extending the borders of Israel. He is a dramatic picture of the believer. We can learn a lot from King Uzziah. He's a dramatic picture of the seriousness that we are to get about the task of getting the gospel out into the world. We are to use every means possible that's legitimate. We are to be very serious about it. We are to be very aggressive about it. I think, for example, when we use radio, suppose that we had some notion. Well, now, wait a minute. Radio, that was invented by unbelievers, and it's so they could satisfy their own lusts. And God has commanded us to go out two by two, and therefore, no way are we going to use radio to send the gospel out. We could argue that way, you know. But the fact is that we look at everything the world has produced, whether it's radio or TV or the printed page or however it might be, whether it's a microphone or a loudspeaker or you name it, a cassette. We want to look at that very, very carefully. Can that be pressed into the service of the war that we are engaged in? That war is to assault the citadels of Satan in order to set people free, in order that they may be saved from their sins. And so it really is, as we study Isaiah, we see that he encourages us to be very, very aggressive and take every precaution, as well as use every effort to that is possible in order to get the gospel out. And his name spread far abroad, for he was marvelously helped till he was strong. Now, he was marvelously helped. I wonder who helped him. I wonder who helped him. You know, that's the wonder. That goes back to verse 5. As long as he sought the Lord, God made him to prosper. And the same is true in the church. If we do it God's way, if we are faithful, we will be marvelously helped. And even though we may in ourselves have no more wisdom than Amaziah had, we may have no more wisdom than a lot of others have had as they've made their mistakes, yet if we have God on our side, we will be helped by him. And I've seen this happen so frequently in family radio, for example, where we may have made a decision that in itself it wasn't a wise decision, and yet God turned it around and really made it into something that was really worthwhile. Well, now, in our next study, we're going to go on with verse 16. We're just going to take a quick look at it. When he was strong, his heart was lifted up to his destruction. This is 2 Chronicles 26, verse 16. So far, it's all been sweetness and light. So far, it's all been marvelous how God has blessed him. Although, remember, we looked at 2 Kings, and we already saw that he had not put down the high places. There were the potential of weaknesses, and of course, that's just very characteristic of the church throughout time. God has given it victory after victory, and yet as we look at any congregation, as we look at the seven churches of Revelation 2 and Revelation 3, we see the weaknesses there. There's the Jezebel there. There's the Nicolaitans. There are other things going on there. They have become lukewarm, and these are all the potential foxes in the vineyard, so to speak. They are the potential places where there's going to be found weakness, and we're finding that can grow into some great weakness that will finally destroy that church. And we're going to see the same thing happening to Isaiah when we go on in verse 16, that he became strong, he transgressed against the Lord his God, and went into the temple of the Lord to burn incense upon the altar of incense. And just jumping ahead a little bit, you remember that who only had the authority to burn incense? Only the priest. Only the priest. And yet here's a man that became too big for his britches. He loved the Lord. He did all kinds of things right. He reigned for a long, long time, 52 years. So I think the longest that anyone ever reigned was 55 years. Yet in his old age, he got proud, and he began to take on responsibilities that he should never have taken, and it brought him into ruin. And we'll see that, and we're going to identify that with the end of the church the same way, that is going to be a picture of how God finally ends the church just before Judgment Day. Well, that's as far as we can get. I hope that we've learned a little bit here that if we seek the Lord, then God will make us to prosper. That is a big point that we don't want to miss as we finish this study. Now we're going to pause for this message and then take some observations or questions from our studio audience. We're continuing with our program, and right now we're going to entertain a question or two from our studio audience. Who has a... Yes?
Yeah, I'm wondering, was King Messiah saved? Because it says here, as long as you, as he did the word of God, he was faithful to the word of God. God blessed him. But then at the end of his life, he became proud.
Yeah.
And his heart was not right with God anymore. Can this happen to a person who thinks they are a Christian and then after many years they become proud and disobedient?
Yes, well, yeah, when we look at, first of all, whether Uzziah was a saved person or not is not the issue. God is using him as a picture of the church. But he, like Solomon, in his old age, got into trouble. Solomon also. Now, we know Solomon was a child of God. There's all kinds of evidence, and yet he worshipped other gods in his old age. It was just astounding. And part of the reason is he hadn't solved all his problems. You know, he multiplied wives. That sin was there. And Uzziah also, you know, he didn't put down the high places. And that's our life, isn't it? We don't get all the sins corrected in our life. We still have a body that lusts after sin, and we still cater a little bit to that. And in our old age or somewhere along the line, we can stub our toe very badly. Believers can do that. Look at David when he committed adultery with Bathsheba. Now, in the case of David, we have a whole account how he repented and everything that went. We don't have that in the case of Uzziah. We don't have it in the case of Solomon. But there's no reason to believe that they also were not completely broken. As a matter of fact, we're going to find out that Uzziah became a leper and that he was confined to his house. He became an outcast, in other words. And he couldn't even reign anymore. His son Jotham had to take the throne with him in order to have a king that the people could see. And so the consequence of his sin was very drastic. Have you had it happen in your life where you were going along quite well and then a sin developed and God clipped you and brought chastisement into your life? Maybe you lost your business, or maybe you lost some of your family, or you may have gotten into all kinds of trouble. It wasn't because you weren't saved. It was just that there were times when you weren't living as close to the Lord as you should. And then God had to do some more training in your life and to bring you around. So God is not really giving us an insight into what's going on in the head of Uzziah and in the heart of Uzziah, except that because he's going to use him as a picture of the church. But I believe this man was a saved man. As we read all that he did and his tremendous faithfulness to the Lord in so many ways, I believe we would have to conclude that. Yes.
So perhaps even that leprosy was a chastisement. I mean,
it was a definite chastisement, although God is using it as a picture of judgment, but it was a chastisement in his life. He didn't get away with it. And in other words, he got the most terrible punishment possible. It's like Miriam, for example. Remember, her hand became leprous. It's when we challenge God, we really, and we can do that as a believer, but then God in his mercy may bring consequences in order to finally humble us, and you'll never do that again, you know. Okay?
In verse 23, it says that Uzziah slept with his fathers and was buried with the kings, and usually isn't that an indication when a king is buried with his fathers that he is a child?
Not necessarily. That doesn't tell. It's a figure of speech to indicate that he was part of a picture of the body of believers, but it doesn't tell us where his heart was necessarily. But that's not important. The important thing is to see the portrait that God is painting here, and God is using Uzziah and his life to paint a picture, not of an individual believer's life, but a picture of the whole life of the congregations, the whole kingdom of God, as God is going to use that throughout the New Testament era to build his church. That's really where God wants our focus to be. Yes.
On that same line, though, You've pointed out that Isaiah reigned for 52 years as an indication, picture of the New Testament era. Would you talk for a few minutes about the fact that 52 breaks down into 13 times 4?
Well, yeah, it's very interesting, you know, that in the 52 years, we also have a further breakdown. We can get 4 times 13 makes 52. And 13, again, as we go through the Bible repeatedly, it focuses on the second coming of Christ. And 4, of course, is universality. And, of course, in the larger sense, the church extends over how long a period of time? Just the New Testament era? The answer is no. In the larger sense, it focuses on the whole period from the fall of Adam and Eve all the way to the end of the world, or 13,000 years. And so in another sense, he is a picture of the church as it has existed throughout time, not only the New Testament era, but throughout time. And in fact, remember the wall of Nehemiah? It took 52 days to build. There again, you have that number 52. And again, ultimately, the wall of Jerusalem, that is the body of believers, takes the whole history of the world to build. Not just the New Testament era, it takes the whole history of the world to build. Okay. Another observation or question? Yes, Hector.
Mr. Campion, the king went into the temple to burn incense, but he was stopped at the sanctuary. So my question is, where did the priest actually burn the incense? In the sanctuary or on the holiest of holies?
We'll get into that later on. We won't get into that question right now as we look at this matter of burning the incense, and we'll develop that in our next study in all likelihood. I can answer your question very quickly. In the holy place, remember the temple was divided into the holy place and the holy of holies. Within the holy of holies was the ark and the cherubim that were over the ark. Remember. And there was that big curtain that separated the Holy of Holies from the holy place. And no one ever looked behind that curtain except on that one day of the year, the Day of Atonement, when the high priest went in. Now, in front of that curtain was the holy place, and there was the altar, but there was the altar where the lambs and the bullocks were sacrificed, but there was also an altar of incense, or a place where the burning of incense, and that went on continuously also. Along with the slaughtering of the lambs, there was the burning of incense in the holy place. Now, on the Day of Atonement, the priest would take a censer, which was a flat plate of some kind, and he would take coals from off the altar, put them on that censer, then he would take some of the incense with him, and go into the curtain, through the curtain, into the Holy of Holies, and he would put the incense on these hot coals so that the smoke of that incense filled the whole building or the whole room of the Holy of Holies. And that was a particular burning of incense. But the burning of incense went on day by day by day by day in the holy place. But only the priests were to burn incense, only the priests.
Yeah. The sanctuary, the holy place.
Yeah. That's the holy place is a sanctuary. That's where the priests officiated over the altar, and they were coming in and out. And every day they sacrificed lambs. Every day they burn incense. Every day there was these blood sacrifices. Anything else? Now, yes.
Well, I was just wondering. I should do this for my own homework, but. In verse 22 of 2 Chronicles 26, it says there, "Now the rest of the acts of Isaiah, first and last, did Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amos, write." I was looking in Isaiah, and the only references I can find to what Isaiah did is in chapter 6.
Yeah.
Then it goes on to speak of what happened during the reign of Ahaz. So I don't know, is there any other place in Isaiah that's recorded that...
I'm unaware offhand. We'll have to double-check that when we get to that. But I think it's primarily, there's a huge focus, you see, on Isaiah 6. Now remember, we're just looking at Isaiah in the broad sweep. We haven't tied in yet to the earthquake. We haven't tied into the year that Isaiah died. And then we'll get some other pictures that God will be painting for us.
Yeah. Do you think that Isaiah is sort of a picture of Satan in that he enters into Satan on the abomination of desolation?
Is that a picture? Well, we'll talk about that next time as to how that kind of fits. But right now we've run out of time. Until our next family Bible study, may the Lord richly bless you.